What do people really think about Aboriginal Australians?
Petrol sniffing and drug taking.
They've got plasma TVs but no food.
I'm Australian, I was born here, just like they were.
Give them houses, they burn them down.
Aboriginal people are definitely more disadvantaged.
Get so much more than us.
Everything costs more for me, but why is it less for them?
A lot of freeloading.
Having this free ride, and I'm working my ass off.
Classing themselves as Aboriginal to get more welfare.
I've had very little to do with Indigenous people.
When it comes to brains, unfortunately.
Aboriginal people keep using the past. Move on.
If you think it's racist, well, I don't fucking care.
6 out of 10 Australians have had little or no contact with Indigenous people. This group represents that 6 out of 10. All with strong opinions, they've agreed to leave their everyday lives behind and embark on a unique journey deep into Aboriginal Australia.
Welcome to Redfern, welcome to what we do.
Jasmine, a mother of 4.
I was to hear that life is hard because they're Aboriginal, I'd better say leave.
Food nutrition student, Alice.
I really align with the Indigenous beliefs.
Trent, a law enforcement officer.
When I hear Aboriginal people say that they can't get a job, I just think it's rubbish.
Supermarket worker, Bodine.
When I think of Aboriginal people, wasters.
Marcus, a part-time photographer.
People that think that Aboriginal families are bludging are just crazy.
And mortgage broker, Sandy.
If the Aboriginal people spending dole checks on booze, don't give them their dole checks.
Guiding this group of outspoken Aussies is award-winning journalist Ray Martin.
You know, the 6 have no idea what's going to happen to them. It's going to be a journey of surprise that they can turn their lives upside down. It'll certainly confront them.
If you got a fucking problem, you bought the problem here. Why don't you close the fucking pubs?
And I think it's going to be a real emotional roller coaster.
I don't think this is going to be very easy for me.
My worst fear.
For 28 days, the 6 will face their fears in a world they never imagined they'd see.
All right, in you go.
I'm not going to be able to stay in here.
The group's preconceptions will be challenged.
Oh, my God.
Good evening.
You are in a crocodile territory.
They'll be tested.
You're now in Robin Regional Prison.
In extraordinary situations.
They're throwing rocks at the car, man.
Their beliefs confronted.
How can the fuck you be 1-8?
Their emotions pushed to the limit.
I don't agree with it. It has to stop.
For the next 3 nights...
It's not fair.
...follow 6 Australians...
Look, my legs are shaking.
...on a journey that could change their lives forever.
We just are trying to survive.
I'm shitting myself.
Just breathe in and out. Just calm down.
Violence, confrontation.
I'm not staying.
It's not about the colour of the skin.
Get off your high horse, girly.
There's no respect there.
This is the way it works here. I'm sorry.
I'm really sorry.
Fuck that. I'm not staying.
It's not what I was expecting at all.
You do not know what we feel.
The 6 travellers have been told they'll be immersed into Aboriginal Australia for the next 4 weeks. Other than that, they know nothing about the journey that lies ahead.
Over the next 28 days, you and I are going on an amazing journey around this country of ours, but you're going to see it in a different light. You're going to get a sense of what it must be like to be an Aboriginal Australian. But let me tell you, it's not going to be an easy journey. You're going to be shocked. You're going to be confronted. For you, Marcus, what do you expect? Are you prepared for anything?
I'm open to anything, but I don't know if I'm prepared.
Sandy, you're going to have to confront your opinions, your beliefs.
I'm probably just nervous about all the arguments I'm going to have with people, like probably with these lot here and also the Aboriginal people and probably lots of other people.
And Jasmine, have you ever met and got to talk to and understand an Aboriginal Australian?
No, my daughters have got friends that are Aboriginals.
Okay.
And they go to school with them and stuff, but it's not a full-on Aboriginal, so...
And you don't spend time with them and so on?
No.
In a sense, do you think you might be ignorant when it comes to Indigenous Australians?
Yeah,
yes.
I do.
Yeah.
Sandy, for you, would you accept the word ignorant?
Yeah, maybe, sort of. Half. I guess we'll have to wait and see. Ask me again later.
Sandy is a successful businesswoman from Newcastle.
Look, what we'd need to do is just set up a self-managed super fund for you.
And she's a mother to 5 mixed-race children.
My kids say that I say racist things all the time, but I don't. I don't think it's racist. I think it's just, they think it's racist because it's something that you probably shouldn't say, but why shouldn't I say it?
When it comes to rating Aboriginal people's talents, Sandy doesn't hold back.
I always say that God gave black people rhythm and soul and, you know, they can all dance, they can all sing and they're all hot when they dance, they all look great, you know, but when it comes to brains, you know, white people have a better gene, you know, better makeup. If you're out there and you're looking at fucking kangaroos jumping past and snakes and goannas and build a fire, like, fuck, how much more can you learn?
Where we're standing here is probably the heart of Australia for Aboriginal people, in the shadow of Uluru. For the Arnangoo people, the local people, this is sacred land. But your journey doesn't start here. Your journey starts about 2,000 k's east of here. We're going to take you to a place where more Aboriginal people live than just about anywhere else in Australia. Not the bush, not the outback, Sydney. I'd like you to jump back in the van and we'll go to the airport because you've got a plane to catch.
The 6 know they're heading for Australia's biggest city, but have no idea what will happen when they get there. Many of Sydney's 50,000 strong Aboriginal population are settled in the city's southwest, which is where Alice, Trent, and Sandy have been sent. For Sandy, an Indigenous person living in the city can only mean one thing.
They're probably all up all night long partying and yahooing, and that's fine, that's not gonna be a big deal. So if they're drinking, well, it's gonna be interesting, because I don't do flagons and goons and port and any of that stuff that they like to drink. So, yeah.
Law enforcement officer Trent has bigger concerns than just drinking.
The only contact that I've had with the Aboriginal people is through my work. You know, the alcohol, the drugs, the domestic violence.
Single dad Trent works in Sydney's west. He deals with Aboriginal families on the front line and thinks they should get their priorities in order.
And I see that, you know, kids aren't well dressed, or the house is not clean, or it's untidy, or there's children just running around with nappies on. And then I look over and, you know, there's no food in the fridge.
Why?
And it makes me bloody angry because, you know, I'm seeing these things and I just think, you know, how can they live like that?
The worst case scenario would be probably staying with an Aboriginal family. So that's what I'm sort of assuming is going to happen. That's where we're going.
Trent's fears are about to be realised. Together with Sandy and Alice, he's moving in with an Aboriginal family for the next 24 hours.
Who's knocking on the door?
Oh,
Trent.
How you going?
How you going?
How you going?
Trent, nice to meet you.
Trent, Vic, how are you?
Vic, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Trent.
Right, come in. Take your shoes off or anything?
No, mate, that's fine. Okay.
Hello. And Trent's in for another surprise. Nice to meet you. Hard-working Victor Morgan isn't the kind of Aboriginal man he's used to.
So these are the kids' rooms down the back.
Yep.
We've got Kayla in this room, my middle daughter Sarah, and my nephew stays in the bottom room, is Adam. We don't exactly fit the stereotype, you know. We ain't our own home. Mm. You know, we've got a pool. You know, the stuff that I got, I worked hard for. You know, it's not been given to me at all. I just, you know, my father said to me, you know, if you want to get along in this world, you've got to be better than the white man.
I'm a law enforcement officer.
Yeah.
So I guess that's probably what's given me that maybe bad sort of
feel
for Aboriginal people.
Yeah. Well, when you get 3/4 of your calls, we're 2% of the population, and 90% of them you call out to Aboriginal families.
Yeah.
It's going to colour you.
Pointed out very clearly that you've never expected anything. Is that something that members of your community do expect? Do they expect welfare?
I want every Aboriginal person to be able to achieve what we've achieved. We haven't done it because we're on welfare, you know, and there's plenty of black fellas out there, Aboriginal people, that are doing the same thing that I'm doing.
Yeah.
You know, and 10 times more successful than what I am.
Mm.
second group of travellers have been sent to Redfern, a suburb synonymous with Sydney's Aboriginal community. Just like Trent, Bodine and Jasmine believe Aboriginal people in the city are a bunch of freeloaders.
They're a bit of layabouts, that they don't really do a lot of things, and they get a lot of support from the government. And yeah, they don't really have jobs.
Just because Aboriginals in the city, because they've got the actual title as an Aboriginal, that entitles them to more, say, like, more welfare, more like housing, free loans, so they get a lot more.
My views where they are now about Aboriginal people, probably on a scale of 1 to 10, like 10 being the worst, are probably about an 8.
You don't want peanut butter?
Jasmine looks after her 4 children in Logan, Queensland.
Pop down off my bench now.
Her family make ends meet with welfare payments, but Jasmine reckons she's being conned by a system that throws money at Indigenous Australians.
I reckon the Aboriginal people are probably getting 4 times the amount that what we get. My husband has to go and work away to earn money for us to live. Bills just, like, keep going up. Like, it's just not fair. It just seems to be a lot of the Aboriginal people are wanting to take, and not give in return.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Jeez. Oh, my God.
Good evening, how are you?
Hi.
Jasmine's theories on welfare are in for a shake-up.
Yeah, well, I'm Jasmine. I'm Bo.
Bo, good to meet you.
Hi. So what is your name?
Shane.
Hey, mate, how are you going?
How are you?
Marcus.
Marcus, good to meet you, mate. Come
you
through.
Too.
Hello, Jasmine.
Jasmine, how are you? Good to
good,
meet
thank
you.
Thank you. Hey, Jasmine. Oh, all right, I'll probably forget Marcus. Names.
He's hungry.
Oh, yeah,
stop.
Shane Phillips is a Redfern community leader, and half his extended family has turned out to meet his guests, including his daughter, Lavina.
Who's having tea and who's having coffee?
Are you going to have coffee?
I'll have a coffee, please.
Coffee?
Yep. Is everyone white coffees?
I am.
Yep. I hope I won't offend.
No, you're all right.
Basically, my understanding is Aboriginal people with children get more than, say, like, myself would get from the government.
Well, my husband, he works full-time job 6 days a week, and I'm on benefits, and we are struggling. I only get... My benefits are, like, $200 a fortnight, so, you know, that's not much...
That's very interesting to find out that you get pretty much the same as what I get.
So
and hubby works too.
Battlers as well.
Yeah, that's it.
Is there a lot of things that you get because you're Aboriginal? Like, is there anything you've come across?
No, like... not much difference. Oh, I can't, not that I can,
She's learned that Lavina gets no more welfare than her, but there's something else that's bothering Jasmine.
My 2 girls have, like, Aboriginal friends at school. Mm. I consider them... Well, I look at them as, like, half. Mm. Like, because they're not the... Well, my typical description of an Aboriginal person is, like, this dark skin.
Aboriginality is a bit like tea. You can add milk and sugar, but it's still tea.
This isn't kangaroo either, okay? By the way, dig in.
Okay.
Lovely. Thank
Welcome.
You. Thank you.
What makes a real Aboriginal person is something the Morgan family are just as keen to set their guests straight on.
Yeah. It's not about the colour of the skin.
Yeah.
You know, it's about what's in here.
Yes.
It's not about 1/8 or 1/16 or, you know, which half here is Aboriginal. Yeah. You know, as I say, I'm half Aboriginal. Mm. Well, which half are you? Mm. You know, is it the bottom half, the top half, or what?
So it's not about the percentages.
No,
and all that
I'm
sort
not
of
a
stuff.
Percentage. I'm you, not.
You still
I'm
hear
not
that a lot.
3/4 Aboriginal. Well, 3/4 white. Okay, I might what you people would say half Aboriginal, but I don't class myself as that. I have a white father and a full Aboriginal mother. I'm Aboriginal. That's all there is to it. Mm. How can the fuck you be 1/8? What the fuck does that mean? Excuse the language, but, you know, that pisses me off. You're either black or you're not. Mm.
It's also dinner time in Redfern. And Jasmine's a little surprised by what's on the menu.
I was thinking that traditional Aboriginal people would be eating, like, bugs. And that's what I actually, I guess, expected. So not, like, steak and chops and chicken and salad. Like, bugs.
You guys want salad down that end?
Just like Jasmine, this is the first time Marcus has ever met an Aboriginal family.
Right now, I'm studying at uni. It's only 4 hours a week. Other than that, I'm surfing, I'm working a little bit, and hanging out with friends.
Marcus lives with his girlfriend's parents on Sydney's northern beaches. He believes his sheltered life means he's never had the chance to meet Aboriginal people, something he wants to change.
I really want to see what Aboriginal Australia is like firsthand, because I think it'll be completely different to this area, the people around here, and how I'm living. For me, I can't live in this perfect bubble the whole of my life. I feel like I'm definitely a blank slate and heading into something that will completely scribble all over that. Like, I've always thought of Redfern as a kind of unsafe area, and yeah, not always sure if people from the northern beaches want to go over there and spend their night there, because they're just worried about, you know, getting mugged or something.
There was a time when it was like that, but the whole community got together and we chose to be the solution and change things. Mm. In a generation, some of these kids will be the doctors, and they could be the lawyers and the police officers and the pilots in this area.
Yeah.
That's what we're thinking. For a long time, we were shackled by our own perception of ourselves. If we looked in crime stats in places, we are way down below. We're no longer the place where we were.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. In fact, the opposite is, in the northern beaches, it's one of the higher ones.
Shame. Shame on us. Yeah, now I know where to bring up my kids.
Where do you want to sleep?
I'll grab the floor if that's all right.
Yeah, that's right.
The first day of this 4-week journey is over, and the six are split over what they've seen so far.
This family, you know, I think are setting a really high standard. Like, they're really lovely, and from what I gather, they want things to change and, you know, change the perception of Indigenous people, but I'm just not convinced that that's the whole idea and viewpoint from the whole community.
It's not what I was expecting at all. Coming into a, you know, a family that's well set up, they own their own home, they're doing renovations, and clearly not relying on welfare.
But for some, this adventure might not last much longer.
Oh, fuck that. I'm not staying. Can't. I can't. I know what happens on those mattresses, and they all sleep on them, with all their sweat and all their partying and all their boozing and yahooing, and I ain't sleeping on them. It's dirty.
Are you ready?
Oh, yeah. Can't you tell?
Yeah. Let's do it. We need you to get moving sort of quick. Your bus will be here soon.
5 a.m., Redfern. After 4 hours' sleep, it's time for Marcus, Jasmine and Bodine to get a wake-up call from Shane.
Good morning, girls. Good morning. Guess what time it is?
Go back to sleep.
No, I'm afraid not. Your bus is going to be here in about 5 minutes.
Oh, what?
Yeah. Yeah. That's good, that's good. Let's move it.
When I think of Aboriginal people, I think of wasters.
Bodine travels across Melbourne every day to work on a supermarket checkout. She doesn't just think Aboriginal people are lazy. Bodine believes they should stop whinging and sort out their own problems.
Aboriginal people saying that they're disadvantaged compared to other people and that they need extra help is crap. I don't think they need any more help. It seems like they've got heaps. You know, there's not much more that everybody can do. I think if you want equality and things, then don't take so much from the government and then still say it's not enough. Like, I think people only get off their butts and do stuff when they know that they have to.
I've got a big day planned for you.
This morning, Bodine's in for a rude awakening.
You're going in a bus out the front. That's going to pick up a bunch of kids to come training, boxing training. We're going to have a good time, and it's going to be punishing.
Shane runs the Clean Slate Without Prejudice boxing classes with the local police to keep Aboriginal kids out of trouble. Bodine's image of lazy welfare bludgers is set to be dealt a blow.
This program we run is a partnership between our community and the police.
Was that implemented here, Shane, or
yeah,
was that...
we created it ourselves.
OK, are other neighbourhoods doing
we it? We created it ourselves. We don't get government funding. We're not... no one funds us. And what we do is show that as a community, we get kids into this routine, so they're up 6 a.m. in the morning to do their exercise, to either go to school or to go to work. That's how it's all driven. You keep talking about the sense of worth, the sense of belonging. With this routine, those three make an unbelievable recipe. All right, let's do it.
Yep.
So this is the National Centre of Indigenous Excellence. Left hook, right hand, left uppercut, right hand.
I don't, it's intense. I feel like I'm moving around the court with the punches.
But Bodine will now discover that this is about more than just boxing. Three times a week, the Redfern Police local area commander joins Shane at the gym.
Just come into the circle, eh?
Last year, we arrested one Aboriginal boy from Redfern, one for the whole year, for a robbery, and that's just unheard of. Our boys don't commit offences anymore.
One of those boys who's turned his life around is keen to tell his story to Bodine.
Into this, she's like, just coming into the boxing, you know, because I had anger problems as well, like, when I was going through school and stuff like that. I got expelled in year eight and then, like, went to behaviour schools and just a long process of, like, going up, down. I was getting into a lot of trouble, going in and out of juvenile, yeah, and...
How old are you?
Oh, I'm only 19
wow.
now.
I don't know, like, the thought of ending up in jail terrifies me.
Yeah. And, you know, now I'm working, like, full-time and stuff.
Oh, cool.
So before, you know, I've taken boats up and down Queensland now, working at marinas,
wow.
work, and just... And I could have done it without Shane, you know, like, having someone, like, a good role model in the community, you know...
I don't know, I'm feeling a bit overwhelmed. I guess that, you know, we could be friends, and that sort of is... strange notion to me because I think that all my things of Aboriginal people have been negative and I guess that the only time I thought I'd ever see them is if they were gonna, I don't know, bash me or something.
Yeah, too.
Thank you, that's great.
Thank you.
Back at the Morgans, Sandy survived the night. But her opinions are about to be tested by Victor, who wants to talk to her about his family's traumatic past.
I just wanted to tell you a bit about where our family comes from, you know, the history of our family and the stolen generation story.
When they go on about the, what was it, babies being taken or stolen generation, things like that, I mean, yeah, that's sad and happened. What are you going to do? There's no point going on and no point whinging about it. And, yeah, they've probably whinged a bit too much.
My father, he was taken in 1933, so he's about 6 years old, when the welfare came and took the kids away. They were rounded up like cattle. When he was 8 years old, they moved him to a place called Kinchilla Boys. It was like a concentration camp.
How long did they stay there for?
They stayed there until the early... Dad stayed there until he was 14 years old. But Nan knew that they were down there. So Nan went there to look and find the boys. And Nan was crying, yeah. You know, and screaming, I know they're here, I want them. I want them back.
So sad.
And she never got them. Mm. They turned her away.
So sad.
Dad promised us, you know, that we would never... God. We'd never,
experience any...
He wouldn't... We'd never experience that thing as well. Yeah. Of being a taken, you know, taken child. And people just say, oh, get over it. Yeah. Get over it, you know? It's in the past, you know? It's not possible.
The six have spent 24 hours living with Aboriginal families in Sydney. This has been their first contact. For Sandy, the journey has already been an education.
So those who went to the Morgan family last night, how did it go? Sandy, what did you learn about the Stolen Generation?
I just thought they were taking children from bad situations and getting them to live and teach them the white man's way and, that was going to be beneficial to some of these kids, I guess, in a sense. I did get an understanding today. Obviously, that wasn't the case. A lot of it was very sad. Everything we heard was sad, the fact that families were just torn apart and children were stripped and taken away, and no government, no person has a right to do that.
OK, I've got to tell you, this is the end of the Sydney part of your journey. You're about to go from Australia's biggest city. You're going to go 3,000 k's this time to one of the most remote places in Australia. You're going to actually go to a tiny community where there is no shop, where there is no mobile phone, certainly, and where there's really no electricity.
Oh, my God. What?
You've got to learn how to hunt for your tucker.
Oh, yes.
And you've got to begin to understand a little bit of a culture that is the longest continuous culture in the world, certainly outside of Africa.
It's incredible. Can't wait.
You can't wait?
Yeah.
You're excited?
Yeah. Really, really, really excited. Yeah, this is what I've wanted to do for many, many years, so, yeah. It's one of my dreams of going to stay in an Indigenous community and to submerge myself within this culture. So to learn their ways, to learn their spirituality, to learn bush medicine, to learn how to forage for food, to learn.
Alice has had next to no contact with Aboriginal people. But she's desperate to know more about the first Australians she feels a close connection to.
You know, I've gone through a lot of processing and understanding, research, reading, and then realised that it's actually Indigenous people around the world that we should be focusing a lot more on so we can, you know, obtain some of their wisdom.
The second leg of the journey has begun. Alice and the group will soon have their opinions confronted in one of the most isolated parts of Australia. But first, they must face their fears just to get there.
Morning, everyone. My name is Mark. Welcome to Martha Galil Line. So we're going to Yinyin Cay this morning. All right. It's
to
a
where?
Small Yinyin Cay.
Yinyin Cay.
It's going to be about a 30-minute flight. The weather's marginal at this stage. It's going to be a bit bumpy. Just keep your seatbelts fastened all the time.
Is there parachutes to just jump out?
Not on this plane.
The wet season means local roads are cut off, and a six-seater plane is the only way to get to Yinyin Cay.
Right.
It's Jasmine's worst nightmare.
I don't want to get on at all.
What's why?
It's too small.
To reach the next location, the six must travel by single-engine plane.
The same size.
Oh, it just doesn't matter, does it, really? If we're fucked, we're fucked.
With Sandy and the others ready to jump on board, Jasmine must decide whether to join them or not.
Oh, shit. It's OK. It's OK. Just breathe in and out. Just calm down. I want the door so I can jump out quickest.
Yep, you can have the door.
Have you had anyone vomit before?
I have many times.
The group is heading to Yinyin Cay in far northeast Arnhem Land, one of the most remote places in Australia. A homeland community The Yolngu people here keep their connection to land and culture alive. Fewer than 2% of Aboriginal people live in communities like this.
It's so hot.
I know.
Look at this place.
Yeah.
Hi. How are you? Cool.
What is Do we get some paint? We're going to get some paint.
As someone who visits the hair and beauty salon three times a week, Sandy's a little anxious about the welcome.
Do I need that special stuff put on my face?
Yes.
Yes.
Go, Sandy.
Sandy. Just throw it on. Throw it on. Throw it on.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Not my hair. Oh, my lovely.
But Sandy's discomfort isn't over yet. The dingo dance is the customary welcome here.
Welcome all.
Love it. That was incredible.
Despite the reception, the group will now find out just how challenging things are going to get from schoolteacher Marcus Lacey.
Where we are sitting now, this is where you'll be camped. See that block over there? That's the shower block and toilet facilities there. You will sleep, eat, hunt with us. You will see everything that is Tua Niritjas.
Are we able to go swimming?
You are in a crocodile territory. All right. So if you're going to go swimming, don't go swimming. We're not going to transform them, but we're going to fill them with the truth coming from our mouth while they're walking on our land.
There are just four houses and a handful of shacks on Nyinyikeh, so the six must sleep in tents just a few metres from the water's edge.
I've got no idea what I'm doing.
This doesn't seem right, this.
This place really is remote, so it's a bit scary if something happens. We can't really get off unless we swim in the croc-infested waters.
They think this is hard, but this is just the beginning.
Around 20 people live here, four generations of the same family. After barely an hour as their guests, Sandy and Alice are already fighting over why the family chooses to live in a remote place like this.
Seriously, you want to live here all your life?
Some people do.
But there's more out there. There's more out there. That's why all the whites and that came to these countries, because we explored,
you don't just stay
in a place like this forever. It's beautiful. You come to places like this for holidays.
Yeah, that's you, though.
Well, what, you're going to live here forever? Would you live here forever?
Well, sometimes, the pursuit of happiness to you is different to me.
It's not about the pursuit of happiness for me. It's not the pursuit of happiness. It's about knowing and exploring, mate. It's about exploring. Other than exploring here in the bush, which is the fucking same for, from here to where we came from, practically. It's just bush. Don't just stay here.
I'm pretty sure it's not a cult.
Experience life.
I'm pretty sure they're not tied here.
You'll find out.
We'll find out. Brainwashed into staying.
We'll find out.
English is not the first language on Nyinyikeh, and the group will soon learn that Marcus and his family are determined to keep their culture alive.
Hit it where you're comfortable at, so here.
He takes the men into the bush to collect bark to use for shelters and painting.
So the idea is to keep balance with your 2 feet and hold on to dear life. Once you reach the top, it should be okay. There you go.
It's tough when you get really close, hey?
I'm fucked.
A world away from Sydney, law enforcement officer Trent is starting to question his narrow view of Aboriginal people.
You know, seeing you guys out here just in the middle of nowhere, living and surviving, it's pretty incredible. But, you know, I go home and I work with and see Aboriginals that live completely different, and a lot of it's very negative. You know, there's a lot of drugs, there's a lot of alcohol abuse, and to see this side of things is pretty incredible.
We're just giving you an insight of what behind all those ugly faces that you might see in front of you, you know, you take this back with you, and then you might communicate differently with them, yep. You know, and then see them as not as lawbreakers or anything, you know, see them just as people who just are trying to survive in a different environment.
Oh, that's what I'm here for. I want to take, you know, some of these lessons that I'm learning. And exactly what Marcus is saying, you know, how can I communicate better with the Aboriginal people in my job as a law enforcement officer?
The women are heading to the mangroves with Marcus's sister, Farah. With no shop on Yinyike, they're about to discover how it feels to live off the land. For Jasmine, this is the moment she's been dreading.
My biggest worry on this trip is I'm gonna have to eat bugs. if I'm honest, Aboriginal Australia does scare me.
What are we doing here, Farah?
They're gonna come and collect mangrove worms.
Mangrove worms?
What are they gonna use the worms for?
To eat them.
Oh,
to
wow, eat them. Are we eating them now?
Yeah.
Or we cook them?
We eat them.
Now?
Yeah, once they collect them.
You can go first. Jasmine put her hand up. She said she'll go first.
Farah and her sisters have been collecting mangrove worms all morning to bring back for their guests. The worms are eaten alive.
I'm not eating the worms. I don't think I could stomach it.
Well, I look at it. Anybody wants to have a taste of it?
Is it alive?
No, sorry.
Yeah,
sorry.
It's alive. Oh,
look how big it is.
Oh, yuck. It's okay, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, it's good.
Okay. And then the guts come out of it? Oh, I don't know if I can. You can do it. You can do it.
Despite her protests, Jasmine finally confronts her biggest fear.
Okay, ready?
Go. It's down.
Can you do it?
No more, no more, no more.
I chewed mine. It was nice. Thank you.
The men are about to get their own taste of what it's like to have to kill to eat. They're going turtle hunting.
Yeah, looking forward to it. Been thinking about it all morning now. Pretty keen.
Only certain Aboriginal people are allowed to hunt protected sea turtle. Hunting is recognised by law as critical to Yolngu culture. For Marcus, this could be the once-in-a-lifetime experience he's been hoping for.
Go! Go to the side there. Quick one, put it. Guys, grab him by the back of the neck. Back of the neck, yep. Watch the mouth.
Yep.
She'll bite.
One, two, three.
That's it. Watch your foot. There you go.
Jesus, that's a turtle.
He may have turned hunter for the day, but the harsh reality proves almost too much to bear for Marcus.
Yes. It's different having it right in front of you. And it's still alive and just on the boat. It's a pretty ancient kind of creature and it predates us. It's crazy to think that you know, you pull it out of the water and and have it just for a meal, but...
It's too late in the day to kill the turtle, according to Yolngu custom. So it'll be kept alive until morning. Back on dry land, tensions are building. Bodine is upset that her hosts aren't the traditional Aboriginal people she had in mind.
I guess I've just always thought that there would be people still living in the bush and stuff, you know, without, you know, the shoes and, you know, the clothes from the supermarket and stuff. Yeah. I don't know.
But is it is the same sort of thing, though, you know? Like, is it really the shoes that make a difference to their culture? Or is it, you know, like, see, what about... Isn't it beliefs more that make a culture?
In my opinion, I think beliefs are an important part, but I think it's also everything else that... goes with it.
Yeah, but did they, is it somewhere stated that they have to wear a loincloth and gum trees over their beard?
But isn't that part of being like with the land and stuff, wearing natural materials rather than something you buy
more connected? That's it.
It runs a lot deeper than that. It's the spirituality, it's their beliefs, it's their, you know, that's more integral to their being than just the, you know, modern amenities and necessities. I think what they're doing is perfect.
Day two on Ninyike, and the six have been told to make their way to the fishing boat. The girls are in for a shock.
Be careful, Bruce. What is alive?
Yeah.
Why is it alive?
The ethics of the turtle hunt begin to tear the group apart.
Why don't they kill it straight away?
There's a special way that it has to be treated, so...
So you leave it in a boat overnight, getting petrified?
Yeah, but that's their custom. Like yesterday you were saying that you agree with what they're doing.
Yeah, but I'm still wondering what it is. I don't know what their customs are.
When we got it in the boat, it was, like, pretty much at home.
It's all too much for Jasmine.
Hey, Jasmine!
I'll go and get her.
It's all right, man.
Deep down inside, I cry for the turtle because I gotta kill it. But I know what I'm doing is the right process. I'm following protocol.
I think as well, Jazz, you also have to maybe consider how the food that you eat, where that comes from and how that's been bred.
So you agree with it, like, do you, Alice? You agree with it? You're having a fun time watching... You're going to watch the turtle be killed, are you?
But for Jasmine, Alice and the rest, the real test is still to come. Time for the turtle to be killed. And Marcus, it seems, has got over his earlier shock of the hunt.
I think these kids don't feel any guilt about it. It's not like a moral question, so that's kind of reassuring in a way. You know that it's just life. That's life. You can't question it.
But questioning is exactly what Bodine and Jasmine are doing. Despite believing life here should be more traditional, they're finding this customary law too much to take.
Like, it's all about respecting all this bullshit. That's not respecting an animal. Like, just dragging on its back.
One rule for one skin colour and another rule for another. It's not fair.
Whatever their objections, Bodine and Jasmine decide to join the others at the site where the turtle will be killed and cooked.
This is the most brutal part of the process. And it will end here. We're going to take the life of this turtle into our hands and into our soul.
I don't agree with it.
I'll tell you this, we have more spiritual connection than you with this animal. More than you will ever understand. This is just the tip of an iceberg of a whole cosmology of knowledge of this land that we are sharing with you. But this is the way it works here. I'm sorry.
It's not just Jasmine who's struggling to cope. Even Alice is finding the reality of Aboriginal custom hard to take.
And we have to prepare it, cut it up the exact way how it was done in the ancient time.
Doesn't mean I'll find it any easier.
Yeah, yeah, it's not just cut in half and thrown on the fire.
And I've always said I can't kill an animal, like I don't kill ants. Yeah. And so, so seeing something be killed, I find it very difficult. I'll probably cry though.
Okay, that's all right.
You've
got to understand, I'm crying inside too.
Yeah.
But Jasmine's still not convinced.
Do you think the laws would ever be changed to stop you guys from catching turtles?
No, it won't. It won't. Don't ask us that question. Ask them people who's running them fishing boats. They kill everything out there. They kill millions, not only turtle, they're dragging kilometres long nets, you know, let alone that net will be torn off and still floating out there and killing more animals out there. You got to remember that. We are sustainable hunters. We don't go out there to get everything, right? We just only go out there to get what we need, what our family needs, and that's it. We're not driving them to extinction. That's not our destiny to do that. Our destiny is to maintain and sustain the life, not only for us as Aboriginal people, but what's out there. We must look after the land, because if we don't look after the land will not look after us.
Finally, the moment the six have been dreading. What?
Yep.
As one of the hunters, Trent's keen to understand the significance of what's going on.
I'm honouring the death of this turtle, but I'm also honouring our ancestors the way they did it. And I'm thanking the turtle by making it holy for us to eat it.
It's pretty powerful stuff.
Yeah. That's it.
Sandy's right also been drawn in.
Oh, I think it's great. I just like the whole watching that experience. You know, I think it's awesome what we've just seen.
The turtle has been cooking for 2 hours and is ready for Marcus to butcher, according to Aboriginal law. The hunters are first up to eat their catch.
What's it taste like?
You try it. And tell me what's it tastes like.
Like tofu?
Turtle juice. It's not that bad.
Now the women must decide.
You try some?
Yeah.
But then if you don't eat it, then why did it die?
That's right.
Everyone else will eat it.
Yeah. Should try it. It's hot.
It's hot.
It's not bad.
I wanted to make that clear.
Sure. All of the group have eaten, apart from one.
How are you holding up, young lady? Not good?
I know it's what you do, but it's not what I do.
Okay. And I accept that, you know. And it's.
That's what I'm still here. I would have stopped.
Yeah. I respect that, and we are grateful for that.
Well, I'd probably react like this if I seen a cow being done too. But you know, it's just I guess a little bit more like.
Yeah.
It's here. I'm seeing it, and it's in my face.
Yep.
And I guess I don't want to accept it.
Yeah. If you can have a taste, we'd be most appreciated. But we're not expecting you to eat the whole turtle. Know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah. You've got to get it very stringy. No.
Marcus's words finally convinced Jasmine to overcome her fears.
Not too bad, but
still a little bit shocked, I guess. It's totally different. I can't even get my head around it. I've just never seen anything like it, so, yeah.
It's not just Jasmine who's had an experience to remember.
Yeah, I'm going to be sad. I'm burnt, I'm tired, I stink. I've got cuts all over me feet, but, yeah, I think I'll miss it a little bit. It's just, it's so untouched. It's just nature at its finest, really.
The group's time on Yinyikang is over. But the six have no idea of the trials that lie ahead. Tomorrow night, the journey continues. The six discover what life is like in one of the most disadvantaged communities in Australia.
They're throwing rocks at the car, man.
The group lives with an Aboriginal family and experiences the harsh reality of their lives.
This area, is this like your kitchen, dining room and lounge room all in one? Is this, this is it?
Yeah.
Next, things get heated in the Red Centre.
You don't think I should respect anybody?
No.
Well, you don't know
anything
about me.
You're a very selfish woman.
And then the journey goes even deeper.
I really feel like I can't breathe.
As the six travellers find out what life is like on the inside.
It's not nice at all.
I'm like shitting myself, like I don't want to, I'm not staying.
Examine the first response to the controversial program First Contact.
Aboriginal people keep using the past. Move on.
Switch over to NITV Channel 34 now. Join me, Stan Grant, for Awaken, First Response to First Contact.